And hello, everyone. So my name is Wei Tian, and I'm working for PayPal. So welcome to my presentation today. So the topic I'm going to talk about today is about the fsck for the OpenStack. So basically, as a operator of the OpenStack cloud, besides the OpenStack code, you have to do something else to make your cloud working for your customers. So the topic I'm going to focus today is about how to detect the resource leakings and also the misconfigurations. So how to do those house cleaning works to make your cloud consistent. So agenda today is I'll just give you some of the numbers about our cloud. And second one is, so I'll just share some of the scenarios why your cloud is get into an inconsistent state. And also I'll give you the next year, what is our solutions to keep the cloud consistent. So I think there was a session in the morning for there's a panel talking about the duct tape, all those kind of hacks to operate your cloud. Actually, we are doing the same thing. The difference here is we try to get all those script tools, whatever stuff, we try to bundle it into our, well, kind of a product. So we want to have a set of the tool set which we can use across the board. So here's the slides if you guys want to download. So you don't have to take pictures for each of the pages. Okay, let's get started. So about PayPal's cloud, so basically we start the OpenStack cloud since July 2012. So today we are have one of the world's largest OpenStack private cloud. So we have 82,000 VMs running right now, and it's growing. And we have 8,064 hypervisors. We have the number of racks is 84 racks, and we have 386,000 cores, CPU cores, and we have 2 PB block storage. So one of our AZs, we have one of the largest AZs for the cloud, OpenStack cloud. So we have. So in one AZ, we have 2,500 hypervisors. So basically, the PayPal cloud, we hosting our 100% of the production services, and also we powers 100% of the PaaS and Dev QA services. And we have the first production workload on the SDN since 2013. So what makes the cloud inconsistent? So there's mostly there's two categories. So one is the misconfigurations. So I'm not talking about, the config files for some services, like say noah.conf. So those configuration is managed by the Puppet. So the Puppet will make sure when you deploy the service, the configuration has to be correct. So the thing is, I'm talking about the configurations after you deploy the service. Next, say if you have if you have a dev stack, you cannot use it immediately, because what you need is, and you need, at least you need to create some flavors. you need to create some network and sublet. You need to upload some images. So basically, in our production cloud, we have to do a lot of preparations to create all the resources for our customers. And so most of them is using the OpenStack API, like say you create flavors, upload images. But things, a lot of things they need to consist. If because all the things is kind of a menu before. So the administrator just doing through the CRI to end those resources. So for the misconfigurations, we have implemented the VPC features. It's kind of close to the Amazon's VPC, but it's for our enterprise clouds use. So basically, it's a little bit different. Unfortunately, the VPC is not in the upstream yet, so we have to do a lot of configurations for this feature. And second is the flavors. So mostly the flavor is say you have to set some special properties for the flavors. So the scheduler knows how to find the right hypervisors. And also for the images. So some images you can use in one hypervisor but not the other ones. So you have set the correct properties. The other one is the host aggregate. So basically, a lot of metadata is used by the scheduler for the host aggregate. Also the default security group. So we have customized the default security rules for each of the VPC. Networks. Networks is we have both the overlay network and bridged network. So you have to configure the right network and subnet. Otherwise, your VM will have no connectivities. And also the volumes. So let's say we have running both production and DevOps. So the production has to be compliance, and DevOps are non-compliance. So the volumes, the block storage provider is different. Another thing is the resource leaking. So basically, if everything is good, there's no bug in the code, it shouldn't happen. But in reality, it happens, especially when you're running a very large scale cloud, when you run it over and over, so being a long time. So you have all those resource leaking happens. So here's a list. Next year we have the VM sprungs. So you have often VMs, and you have often disks. So if a VM is deleted, but the disk file is still there. So, and also you have we found, so all those issues we encountered is second one is the cinder volumes. So sometimes you know what think this volume is attached, but Cinder thinks it's not. And we found often the ports in the neutron. So sometimes the VMs is deleted, but the port is still left over there. And also in the production we have the DNS entrance. When you create VMs, we'll give you a DNS FQDN for that. So sometimes you may have, like say, one IP with two DNS or two IP with the same DNS. Since we use the NSX for our SDN provider, so sometimes the data in the neutron, they are not consistent with the NSX. So all those things happens in the reality. And also, there's inconsistent state caused by the RPC timeout. So the RPC timeout is one service send a message say to another service say doing something, and it wait for the response. So, but somehow the responses get lost or whatever, RabbitMQ issues. So it didn't get a response. So it's timeout. It's timeout. So the service A thinks this operation has failed. But service B actually does the job. It didn't set the response back. And also, we use multiple cells. So basically, cells, they try to synchronize the database, the status. Like a VM status is changed, it should sync from the computer cell to the API cell. Sometimes it didn't happen. And so, yeah. So the misconfiguration, I think I already talked about some of the details. So mostly it's because it's a manual process. Because you have to set, the administrator has to manually set up a lot of stuff. So as long as we are human, so we are bound to make mistakes. So give you one of the examples, a very simple one. So if you want to say, I have a SSD, I have a set of SSD hypervisors. So I want to have a flavor, say, this flavor is support SSD. So this, if user choose this flavor, it has to go to the SSD hypervisors, with the hypervisor with the SSD drives. So the way you do it is you set an extra spec in the flavor, say, there's a SSD, it's true. And you have to, then you have to set the same thing, say, in the host aggregate, you have to create a host aggregate, say, it has a metadata, say, SSD is true. So the NOAA scheduler try to match them. But since this is a manual process, so there are a few steps. You, like say, you create a flavor, you create the host aggregate, you set the extra spec. You may have a typo, like say, in the flavor, the true may be lowercase, but in the host aggregate, you may have an uppercase true. All those things happens. And you may add the host into the wrong host aggregate. So this is a very simple example, but when people make mistakes, so it won't work. So this is a more complicated scenario. So currently the VPC is managed by the administrator, it's not a self-service, which means if a department come to us, say, can you create a VPC for us? So we need to configure a lot of stuff. So the middle box, the VPC, actually this is not our OpenStack object because it's not exist. But the thing is, so the VPC is kind of a tagging in all the other resources. So we try to hook up everything, like say, we have a admin tenant for the VPC, this one. And then we need to define the shared networks for this VPC. And we need to config the security group for this VPC. And we have two special images for this VPC. And then we need to create, like say, host aggregates for this VPC. So there's a lot of things to do. So all those things, all those configurations, you can down to the OpenStack CRI. But when you're doing like 10 or 15 steps, you may make mistakes. So the other one is say so misconfiguration. I just gave two examples. There's others. Whenever an administrator has to manually do something, mistakes happens. So second part is the resource leaking. So when you're running the OpenStack for a very long time, the resource leaking happens. So it impacts your capacities. Like say you have disk file, very huge, like say 30 gig disk file left on the hypervisor, so you cannot use it anymore. And sometimes it causes operation failures. So we have this, like say, resource volume issues, instance issues, port issues. And sometimes it's not able to correct the state through the REST API or the CRI because the state is messed up already. So the way you can correct those issues is if you know the database schema behind, you can go to the database, just edit something. And also you can run a shell script on the hypervisor to correct the state, to delete the orphaned disk files, something like that. So those are not standard OpenStack operations. But you have to do it. It's just like, say, we have cron jobs to restart service in case of something wrong. So yes, we know it's important to find and fix the underlying root cause, right? But as an operator, as a service provider, you have to fix the issues immediately. And of course, the dev team need to figure out like, say, why this happens. But you know, it takes time. So here's I just gave some list of our examples for the resource leaking. So one of the things is the orphaned VMs. Sometimes you delete VMs. Actually, it's not deleted. It's still running on the hypervisor. So in the NOVA table, you say, oh, this instance is deleted, but it's still running. Sometimes the instance is deleted, but the disk file is still there. So this thing happens. And the other one is the volumes. So sometimes the state in the sender, they are inconsistent in the NOVA. So NOVA thinks it's attached, sender thinks it's not. Sometimes when you try to detach a volume, it's stuck in the detaching state forever. And there's a NOVA resend state for volumes, but it's not always works. And Neutron has orphan ports. So especially for our bridged network, because each port is associated with the IP, which means if you have port leaking, you have IP leakings. So you are still run out of the IPs. You cannot provision any new VMs because you run out of IP. And also we have some issues with the Neutron and the NSX controllers. So the other one is the DNS. So DNS is not part of the OpenStack resource, but in a production cloud, it's very important because all the other services, they reference the VM through the DNS. Mostly they use DNS, the FQDN instead of IP. So if your DNS entry messed up, it's so your application may not work. So we are part of our ASIS, we have tried the designate. So we are kind of one of the contributors to designate. And before that, we also have an in-house service to do the DNS binding and unbinding. So basically the idea is whenever you create a VM or delete VM, so NOVA send notifications to the message bus. And we have a service just listen to the applications. So the DNS binding and unbinding, they are unsynchronized. Sometimes it didn't happen. And I already talked about the inconsistent state caused by the RPC. So this part is we found more issues with the multiple cell environment. So when you have API, when you have use cells, sometimes our command has to go through a lot of services through the RPC calls. So any of the RPC call failed or timeout, and so OpenStack code, mostly they don't have transaction controls, which means if an operation has five steps, if the 1, 2, 3 passed but 4 failed, some state are inconsistent. And we found this database inconsistent, like say some information in the block device mapping in the AZ they are not in sync with the cell. So to resolve those two issues, so we are developing two projects to just maintain our operations. So basically, those two projects are still ongoing, but actually the pieces for those projects are already there. So some of them are in Python code, some of them are in script, some of them in cron job. So we want to put all of those tools together into two big projects. So basically, we have a cloud builder, which resolves the misconfigurations. We want to eliminate the manual steps to set up the OpenStack resources. So we try to automate all the setup process and to avoid the human errors. So the way to do that is, we try to declaratively define what we want instead of say, you have a script which do 10 steps. So we try to define and say, this is the flavor we want, this is the host aggregate we want, and the code will configure everything for you. So it's just like Puppet. If you change your config file, the next time Puppet will overwrite your config file. So you cannot. So Puppet master always keep your config file inconsistent. So the cloud builder does the same thing. If you, like say, if I define a flavor in my config file, say this is the flavor for this VPC, and somebody go to the CRI, well, you have the admin access to do that. But somebody go to the CRI to change the flavor, and the cloud builder will figure out, hey, this thing's changed, and it will overwrite, just like the Puppet does. And the other project is the cloud sweeper. So basically, we try to put all those little tools together and to fix all those resource leakings, and we are adding more and more tools. And we also need things, since we put all those things together, we can have a report, we can have a dashboard to view the result, like say what we cleaned, I mean, what's going wrong. So it's very handy for our operator. So the thing is, for the configuration is we try to have a blueprint, which means everything is data driven. We don't want you to do script. So we'll have a set of the JSON files which defined the resources you need. And those JSON files will be checking into the GitHub. So which means if you want to make a change to the production cloud, you have to go through the code review process. So after the JSON file gets changed, of course we have validations. Then it will go through the same process. It'll get pushed to the production and it will get applied automatically. So here's an example. Like say we have our JSON file for the VPC metadata. So for our VPC, like say each VPC you can have different properties. Like say the host name you can customize. Say for my VPC I want to have a pattern for my host name next this. Like say for each VMs the NTP server could be different. The DNS domain is different. So a lot of things you can customize, and even the image properties, you want to use config drive or not use config drive, a lot of things you can customize. So when you define this, so when you want to add a VPC, what you do is you just add an entry in this config file and it will automatically get pushed to the production. So here's another thing is, we want to, let's say, what is the resources associated with the VPC? So we'll define some flavors. Next is some flavors is for high memory, some flavor is for high I/O, which you have the SSD drive. And for the images, because different VPCs, their images, the cloud ini script is different for different VPCs. So we have special image properties defined for the images. And the other part is, let's say, the default security group. So each VPC can be different. So you have VPC based the default security rules, which means whenever you so user can create their own tenant, and their tenant automatically inherited the security groups defined by the VPC. And also another one is very tedious works. If you define all those mappings, flavors, host aggregates, sometimes people add the hypervisor to the wrong host aggregate. So basically, in our system, we have a config management system. It's called CMS. So basically, when the hardware is onboarding, what is the serial number, what is the CPU memory, the types, models, they are in the CMS system. So the tools will look into the CMS system to figure out, like say, if this hypervisor should belong to our production server, so it can figure out by the subnets or some other properties. So we try to automatically add hypervisors to the right group. Sometimes if you cannot, it will give you a list, say, so you have to manually adjust some of them. So the cloud sweeper, so what I said is we have all those little tools try to fix our the resource leaking. So we try to group them together. So what it does is, so we try to have this task executors. So different tasks, they all have the same interface. And then you have a task, the scheduler. Like say, some tasks you should run every day, some tasks you need to run every hour. And the other part is you have a report tool. So basically, we are doing a dashboard, try to view the scheduling and the task result. So currently, we have our, we have four cleaners. Next year, one is for Neutron, one is for the volumes, and another one is for the NOAA part, another one is for the DNS. And the top is the tools. Next year, sometimes you can fix something through the OpenStack client. So I'm talking about the OpenStack Python client. So you can call the API to do some fix. Sometimes you cannot, so you have MySQL drivers. You can go directly to the database to change something. And also we have the NSX drivers. You can directly go to NSX to delete a port or to fix something. And we use Fabric. So basically the Fabric is a SSH tool in Python. So the Python code can directly run commands on all the hypervisors to run some shell script, whatever things you want to do. It has the root access. And of course, we have a unified DNS server, so basically we have the drivers for that. And for the backend, we have the solid file drivers to fix the volumes if we need. Just give you two examples, like say how the cleaner works. So for the open ports, what we do is the process will scan the Neutron table. So basically, if a port has device ID, then we try to check. So the device ID is the instance ID in the NOAA table. So if a port has device ID, we want to check, say, what is the status for this instance. If the instance is active, everything is fine. If the instance is deleted or is in deleting state, so then we need to do something. So the other path is if a port has no device ID, which means something failed in the middle because the device ID is not ready yet. So we'll check the owner of the type. if this, the owner is Noah, means it's a instance creation. So if we found an orphaned port, then we will remove the orphaned port from the neutron DB. So we just mark deleted as true. And we also, then we will run the NSX driver to remove the port from the NSX. Then we'll scan the next port. So it's a simple tool, but it really works. So the other ones, example is for the volumes. So basically, we scan the volumes in a VM. So we want to know if the volume is so we want to try find the source of truth. So this guy said the volume is attached, the other guy said it's detached. So the source of truth is on the hypervisor. So the fabric code will go to the hypervisor to check if the iSCSI session exists and active. So if it's active, then we'll check the VM configurations. We are just call the nibword API directly to check, say if the volume is attached to the VM in the nibword.xml or nmist.x. So the thing is, if everything is fine, I mean if the volume is in the hypervisor and is attached to the VM, and the state is not good, so mostly what you need to do is you probably need to reboot the instance to get the warning attached. So if a warning is in Noah table set attached, but actually you don't have an active iSCSI session in the hypervisor, so basically, which means this warning actually has some issues. So if the warning is not configured, so we will try to delete the iSCSI session on the hypervisor. So we want to release the volumes, and then we will set the state to detached. So some of the state change you cannot do it from the API. So we just go directly to the database and mark that warning as deleted. And so if we want to delete something else from the, so the thing is we have to fix different DBs. Let's say when we fix Noah DB, if there's a mismatch, then we have fixed the Cinder DB if there's a mismatch. And for different cases, we may need to reboot the instance to, let's say, let the instance reconnect to the volumes. So that's the end. Thanks for coming and questions. Yes, please.
Are you using a certain type of configuration management software? And you created a new configuration management software to configure OpenStack instead of creating module for existing configuration software. Why?
Sorry, I didn't...
Instead of creating a module for existing configuration software you're using, Puppet, Chef, I don't know, why you created a new software which basically invented it again?
So it's different. So what I said is, let's say, Puppet module deploy, let's say, my Noah service, and it configs, let's say, my Noah.conf, right? So you try to make all those things consistent. So my Noah is running. But what we are doing here is the resource inside the Noah. Let's say a flavor.
Why you do not control flavors by
Puppet?
By Puppet. Add one more module, it's not a big deal. It's easier than create a new software.
So mostly the Puppet, you can write your own class then, right? So because all the operations we have done here, it's done in the Python code. So basically, you can let Puppet drive this, But it also can be driven by a cron job, right?
Clean job. Yeah. So how do you separate this? This pod, you think this pod he did not have the owner, so you want to delete it. But how do you know this is not in the middle of one crater VM normally?
That's a very good question. So basically, in the first version of our neutron cleanup script, so when somebody creates a VM, the script gets triggered, and it deletes their pods before they finish the booting. That's a very good question. So now we check the timestamp.
So how you do to avoid to do this? Because before we also think about to do a cleaner, but we think we can avoid this situation. So we did not do that. So I want to know how do you to avoid?
So we know, like say, how long it takes to create an instance.
Mm-hmm.
So like say, especially say how long it takes to create a pod.
Mm-hmm.
So mostly we set a time longer than that.
Mm-hmm.
So the thing is, if a pod has no device ID for like 30 minutes, there must be something wrong. So your instance creation will fail. Definitely, maybe it's already failed.
Okay, so this is dependent on all the operation is done by the task, because if there's another client, they partnerate, do you create a VM, create a pod, then you don't know.
So basically we have more controls in our own cloud because we are kind of private cloud. So we manage what the customer can do, what the customer cannot do.
Okay.
So it's not like a public cloud, you know.
Okay, thank you.
Given what you've shown, let's say you have a scale, you know, 1,000 networks. How often do you recommend running this as a cron or whatever, and how long does it take to do one full sweep of things?
So currently, I think we run it next every hour.
Okay, once.
So it's not.
And how long does it take? You know, I don't know how large your network is.
So it depends. The thing is. So for us, most of the VMs has one port.
Ah.
So which means if you have, like say, 10,000 VMs, you have 10,000 ports to scan, so it's not a big deal.
Okay. And then when you are doing all this cleaning up, are you logging it properly so that your log actually says, okay, your cloud sweeper actually did this work rather than some...
we are working on that.
Okay. Because that's pretty critical, right? You need to have that audit for that.
Yes.
Otherwise,
so basically, the point is, if you use the CRI, you have the user ID then, right?
Right.
But if we go to the database,
exactly.
So that's why we need to log our own actions.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's work in progress, right?
That's in work in progress.
And
yeah.
This piece of work, you're upstreaming it?
It's not in the upstreams. It's.
Do you plan to upstream?
This is a hard question. So some of the tools, like say, it may benefit other people's, and some of the tools it may not. So basically, I think that the biggest issue is the time restraint. Since we are kind of very small team, so we.
Why not put it in GitHub and let others?
We should, so I think we can contribute part of those tools to the upstream.
Okay, thank you.
I guess it's a follow-up question. Is the source available for this?
The source is not available now because we are still doing the works. I just told you some of the is in Python, some of is shell script. And some of this is in the cron job yet.
Yeah, I mean, it's okay. There was a talk earlier today about duct tape and bubblegum about
exactly.
How operators have to do things like this. And there's an organization, GitHub, where operators...
Yeah, so that's part of the things we want to do is we try to give back some of our works to that
All right.
group.
Thanks.
So any more questions? Okay, thank you for coming.